Turn in your Bibles, if you would, please, to the book of Jeremiah, chapter 32. Jeremiah, chapter 32. Have you ever tried to consider the size of our universe? It is not easy, but let's give it a try for a moment. Let's say we had a car with wings, and that car could travel, say, at 186,000 miles per second. Pretty fast. You realize traveling at 186,000 miles per second that we could make it to the sun in about 8 minutes. It would take us about 6 hours to travel to the planet Pluto, by the way, which is only about 4 billion miles away. It would take us 4 years and 4 months to travel to our nearest star, and to travel to the farthest star known to man, it would take us about 500 million years traveling at 186,000 miles per second. Does that help you to understand the size of our universe? Not really. So let's try it another way, all right? Let's say, for example, we wanted to go to the next and yet nearest galaxy known to man. It would be the galaxy Virgo. Now, Virgo is only about 50 million light year away. Did you hear that? 50 million light year away. But we didn't want to travel at 186,000 miles per second because, you know, that's a little bit too fast. It's hard to take in the sights and the sounds of the universe traveling at 186,000 miles per second. So we're going to take this car with wings and we're going to slow it down to a mere 70 kilometers per hour. All right? That way, you know, we could, you know, kind of drink in the sights and the sounds of the universe, you know, saying, hey, you know, look at that. That's pretty cool and so on. Hey, but do you realize traveling at 70 kilometers an hour, in order to get to Virgo, it would take you 12 million years to travel 1 light year. Which means you would still have about 40 million plus light year left to travel. Does that help you to understand the size of our universe? You probably say no. And rightly so, because you know that our universe is so vast, it is so grand, that it is literally beyond human comprehension. But here's the point. Do you realize that our God spoke all of that into existence? Which reminds us that our God is a God of great and mighty power, that He is a God of infinite, unlimited power. And yet, do you realize that there's absolutely nothing that that God can't do? In fact, the Bible is constantly reminding us that this God, our God, yes, is a God of infinite and unlimited power. And when we, by faith, trust that God, we will discover in our own life, our work, and our own ministries, that there's absolutely nothing too difficult for Him. You know, when we come to this passage here in Jeremiah chapter 32, we find Jeremiah in prison. He was put there by King Zedekiah because they viewed him to be a traitor. And as Jeremiah was looking through the bars of his cell, he saw King Nebuchadnezzar of the Babylonian Empire with his vast army coming, ready to sack the city. And Jeremiah, that prophet, knowing that within a few days the city of Jerusalem would be totally destroyed, it would probably set ablaze, the possessions of his people would be drawn away, and the people would be led into captivity. Probably, without a doubt, a low point in Jeremiah's life. Could you imagine this great prophet of God called, you know, to bring the people in a living relationship with God, seeing his beloved city and seeing his beloved people about ready to be destroyed? And it was at this low point in Jeremiah's life that the God of heaven came to Jeremiah and gave him these encouraging words found in Jeremiah 32 and verse 15. Listen to what the Lord said. For thus says the Lord of hosts, the God of Israel. He says, Jeremiah, I want you to know something. He says, as you look through those iron bars and you look in the city of Jerusalem, you see utter destruction. You see your people being scattered, utterly destroyed, but I want you to see something. I want you to know something. I want you to know what I know, that houses and fields and vineyards shall be possessed again in the land. In other words, Jeremiah, this may to you look like a hopeless situation, but it's not. Jeremiah, knowing that God was a God of infinite and unlimited power, he came back and he prayed this great prayer of faith found for us in verse 17 of Jeremiah 32. Notice how he responded to the words of the Lord. Jeremiah responded and he said, oh, Lord God. He says, behold, you have made the heavens and the earth by your great power and outstretched arm. There is nothing too hard for you. You see, Jeremiah knew that God was a God of infinite and unlimited power. And in response to Jeremiah's faith, the God of heaven came back and he said these words to Jeremiah in verse 27. Notice he says, behold, he says, Jeremiah, I am the Lord, the God of all flesh. And is there anything too hard for me? In other words, he was saying to Jeremiah, listen, you're right. Your understanding of me is a correct one. I am a God who spoke all that you see and know in existence. And I am a God of infinite and unlimited power. And why, when you put faith in me, Jeremiah, there's absolutely nothing too hard for me. And based now upon Jeremiah's understanding of God, listen to what God said. He said, Jeremiah, now, based upon your understanding of me, will you call upon me? And I promise I will answer you, and I will show to you great and mighty things that you know not. And friends, one of the most serious and yet searching truths of Scripture is the fact that when you and I, as God's people, put faith in God, we will soon discover that there is absolutely nothing too hard for the Lord. In fact, the Bible makes it clear that the infinite and that unlimited power of God is available to those who believe. Can I say it again? The Bible makes it clear that the power of an infinite, all-knowing God, that God who spoke all that we see and know into existence, is available to those who believe. I think Jesus made this clear in Mark chapter 9. You remember the situation. Jesus has just empowered his disciples to go forth and to heal the sick and to cast out demons and do the work that God had called the disciples to do. And remember, the disciples, they came upon a demon-possessed boy that they could not deliver. And yet Jesus, when he heard that these empowered disciples, instead of taking a step in faith and accessing the power of an almighty God, they stepped back in unbelief and left this boy deluded and deceived and damned by a devil. Jesus comes to these disciples and he makes this statement here in Mark chapter 9. These are tragic words. He said to his disciples, O faithless generation, if you can believe, he says, all things are possible to him who believes. In other words, he's saying, listen. He says, men, don't you realize that the power, my power, is available to you if you would connect with me through that simple choice of faith. Again, Jesus made this very same statement to his disciples, and this time he's beginning the last week of his sojourn on earth. And Jesus, so desperately wanting his disciples to live a life of faith, he said these words to his disciples in verse 21 of Matthew 21. He said, assuredly, I say unto you, he says, man, if you have faith and you don't doubt, he says, you will not only do what has been done to the fig tree. And remember the story the day before, Jesus had walked by this fig tree and he saw that it had no figs. And so he withered that tree. By the way, he didn't wither the tree because he was mad that tree did not provide him his morning meal. He withered that tree because he wanted to teach the disciples a valuable lesson on faith. And so the next day he comes by this withered fig tree. And the disciples asked the question, Lord, how is it this tree is so quickly withered? And Jesus turned in order to stir their faith so they might access the power of God. He said, this men, he says, I say to you, if you have faith and you doubt not, he says, not only will you do what has been done to the fig tree, but also if you say to this mountain, be removed and cast into the sea, it will be done. You see, he was reminding us that he is a God of infinite and unlimited power. And that if we as the people of God by faith trust him, we'll soon discover that there's absolutely nothing too hard for the Lord. You know why? Because there's absolutely nothing too hard for the Lord. Maybe you find yourself today in a seemingly impossible situation. Maybe your world is caving in around you, or maybe, you know, you find as if your life, your ministry, your work seems to be going nowhere. Or maybe you find yourself overcome by the physical or financial or spiritual difficulties of life, and humanly speaking, there's no way out. I want you to know something. When you by faith trust God, you will soon discover that in your life, and in your problems, in your situation, in your circumstance in life, you will find a God. And in that God, you will see that there's absolutely nothing too difficult for him. He can lift you out of the muck and the mire that you find yourself in. He can solve your problems. He can answer your prayer. He can meet your needs. But you need to meet that God in that simple choice of faith. And so I want to speak upon the subject here this morning entitled, Is There Anything Too Hard for the Lord? And I hope as we leave this auditorium today that you'll walk out of here saying, you know what, there's absolutely nothing too hard for my God. You know why? Because there's absolutely nothing too difficult for God. And when you meet that God in faith, you will soon discover that God is your God. And there's absolutely nothing too hard for Him. So when we by faith trust God, what are we going to see God do? Well, let me give you a few thoughts. First of all, when we by faith trust God, you will find that there is no promise in the Word of God that is too hard to be realized. You will discover that there's no promise too hard to be realized. You remember that great story in Genesis chapter 18? Abraham there is sitting under the terebinth tree in Mamre, and he's looking out. He sees the angel of the Lord and two companions coming towards him. And so, you know, Abraham being a gracious host, he, you know, opens up his tents, he invites them in, they sit down. I believe they probably made a strong pot of coffee and a baklava, and there they are, you know, enjoying the better things of life. And as they're talking, the angel of the Lord says to Abraham these shocking words. He says, Abraham, he says, I want you to know that your wife Sarah is going to have a son. Do you realize that those words must have rocked Abraham's world? I mean, just putting back reeling, because you remember Abraham was 100 years old and his wife Sarah was 90 years old. Their body were beyond child-producing age. And Sarah was hiding behind a curtain, and she was kind of listening to the conversation of the men. You know what I mean, ladies? Men are in the living room. Wives are in the kitchen, kind of listening to what the men are saying, you know. And so there was, you know, Sarah kind of listening behind the curtain. And you know what she heard? She heard the angel of the Lord say, your wife Sarah is going to have a son. And the Bible says that Sarah laughed. And you know that this was not the laugh of a schoolgirl. It wasn't just the mere giggle, you know. This was the laugh of unbelief. I mean, she was saying, come on, give me a break. You got to be kidding. Do you think I was born yesterday? I'm 90 years old. My body is beyond, you know, the child-producing age. Give me a rest. This is not going to happen. But you know what Abraham and Sarah failed to realize is that which is impossible with man is possible with God. So the angel of the Lord, seeing the unbelief and the doubt of this Abraham and Sarah, said these words found in Genesis 18 and verse 14. He said, is anything too hard for the Lord? And the answer to that question is no. You see, because when we by faith trust God, do you know what we'll soon discover? Listen, we'll discover in our own life, as Abraham and Sarah discovered, that there is no promise too hard to be realized. Hey, God is a God who keeps covenants with men. God makes us promises. In fact, do you realize in the Bible, there are over 8,000 promises that God has made with man. And these promises, every one of them, they are to be claimed by faith. In fact, we read in Hebrews chapter 11, that great hall of fame of faith. And we see there the exploits of the great men of the past, Abraham and Moses and Elijah and so on. And the Bible says in Hebrews 11 and verse 33 that these men and women, through faith, they obtained promises. You see, God has made us promises, 8,000 of them in the Scripture. He's made a covenant with man. And God expects us to claim these promises by faith. In fact, it was Charles Spurgeon who said, I have thumbed my Bible a many a year, and I have never yet thumbed a broken promise. You know why? Because God doesn't break His promise. God keeps His word. But we need to stand upon that promise by faith, and we can trust a faithful God to fulfill His promise. And when we stand upon that promise in faith, hey, we will discover that there is no promise too hard to be realized. I hope you have a promise that you stand upon. Do you have do you have promises that you hold on to? Guys are as quiet as the first service.